So I will be playing a song by Ecuador Monta. And so our job right now is just to center ourselves, feel your weight in your seat, feel your feet become calmed. Any other energy you have that's not calm, let that be calm. And just go ahead and close your eyes, and we're visualizing the music, okay? So any colors that come to mind, we're gonna take a mental note. Any types of shapes that come to mind, take a mental note of that as well. Okay, go ahead and start to feel yourself come back. Open your eyes when you're ready. So I'm gonna let the music continue to play. Can you all hear the music? Yes, okay. So for this project, I brought out a couple of different mark-making tools. I've brought out, let's see if I can show this. So I have oil pastels with me. They mark really well on the canvas. I have some watercolors. I also have some butcher paper. So I was kind of thinking that the oil pastels could be very similar to crayons, and trying to think about using things that you would already have in the classroom, or things that students who are home might already have access to. I think some of the most common art materials that you buy when you're doing elementary school projects or middle school projects is probably the crayons and the color pencils. The watercolor paints, right? So I have those set up with me. And once you have your students enter that mind zone of visualizing the music, then you just have them start making marks to that music, right? When I do this project, I do like cultural music. I also like music that doesn't necessarily have words. Once you bring in the words, it's sort of a distraction. We start to interpret. So we're really just wanting the sound for now. Thank you. Okay, I'm switching it up. I'm going to do that one more time because that wasn't different enough. And at this point, you could choose to do another paper, or you can have the students keep going on the same paper. I think I'm going to switch over to my butcher paper. And so lately also, I've been doing a few online classes. And I've been encouraging my students to look around the house to see what kind of materials they have to paint on. So one of my classes has done paintings on, so this is a Trader Joe's bag. You can see by the fork at the very top, or even just the back of the Trader Joe's bag so as to not have that marketing on it. So this is a great quality of paper to paint on, surprise, surprise. Also cardboard. So here's a cardboard I have, and I painted a little mango and some blueberries. So I was actually showing them another artist's work from Long Beach, and he's doing migrant workers in the fields and painting beautiful portraits of them on produce boxes. So I'm just gonna move on to my butcher paper under recognized art making materials here, and I'm gonna switch to paint. Switch songs also. I'm hearing that rain stick, so I'm going to add some rain to this. Okay, I'm really switching the vibe here now. This might have some words. So I'm switching colors. I have these little dots kind of trying to mimic what I'm hearing. Orange, because my energy has changed. Okay, sort of giving myself another visualization, time to adjust, hear what's going on. Come back to my canvas. And I can post pictures of the sort of finished projects again in that folder at the end. So I'm going for blue. This is a Jason Becker guitarist. He's soothing me, so I'm going for blue. See if that lasts. Thank you. I love drips. Okay, let me see where we're at with time. I am flipping the switch. I'm going to just change the orientation of my canvas. See what the next song is. Again, kind of returning to the visualization. What sort of moods are associated with this?
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to pause that. I want to talk a little bit about my setup. So if you choose to do some kind of demonstration of drawing or art making, it's a little bit of a challenge. So I've noticed these past few weeks of trying it online. I have two easels. I have one that you see here holding my painting. I have one holding, let's see if I could flip this. I have one holding my phone. So easel here, and easel here. I also have some Jackson Pollock up here for inspiration, who would also definitely fit into this category. His pieces were having to do with dance. Do I have any questions? Any suggestions? Anyone doing anything similar?
I guess, what kind of additional prompts would you give to students so that, if they just kind of sit there staring at their blank canvases?
One of my suggestions to them would be to pick a color, right? So if this song could be a color, what color would it be? And just prompt them to start making marks to the beat would really help. And I do that too once I kind of, if I get stuck on something. So with the last song I played, it was some African beats. So I picked some very neutral colors and then I moved into, let's see. So neutral colors and then moved into mark making from the beat. And that really helped me. So that's probably what I would have that student do. So that's where the visualization comes in handy. So once they have that time to really sort of meet with the music, right? When we close our eyes, we tend to have a fluttering of light, maybe some different colors, maybe some shapes pop up. So encouraging them to pay attention to that mind space and see if they can try to bring any of that out into the physical with their painting or their drawing.
Have a suggestion. I was actually drawing them, but I only had my pen, so I noted down the colors. But if your students are stuck, you could have them get up and try to move their body in the shape or form that they are feeling, and then sit down and try to paint that as well.
Yes, so I'm all about, right, we all have our different learning styles or different ways of learning. So if someone is more kinetic learner, you're going to want to dance, right? I'm playing music in the classroom or I'm playing music virtually. You know, take your little moment to really like absorb it physically and then see how you get to release that afterwards. Thank you, Lisa. That was great. Was anyone else drawing along or making anything along? Yeah.
Hey Joe, you're front and center. Did you are you popping in to stay or just observe?
No, I should probably get a less intense background. No, I'm here just to learn and check it out because I already know how awesome and amazing Aida is. But I haven't seen this before.
Sweet. This is a trial run for me. I haven't done this in the classroom, but I'm thinking with this virtual learning that more things are possible when I have this type of audience, where it's, I feel like the students are more able to focus individually, and we don't have as much of that like peer centeredness where they're kind of just like, well, I can't do it because what is so and so going to think of me, or right, if someone's I get up and dance, someone's going to look at me funny. But when we're in this virtual learning space, it's like we can take opportunity of that, like, hey, you're on your own, how are you receiving this lesson, and what's the output, and did you enjoy it, and did you have fun? And I found it really inspirational at the virtual learning right now that we're doing, that I can be that part of someone's day, the creative part of someone's day, right? So I'm having different prompts. I prompted my middle schoolers to do ready-mades. And even though they're a little confused about like why they're doing this, I'm like, hey, I just want you to have fun. Look at the world differently. Let's make some silly shapes out of what we have, right? I'm doing the Getty Project next, where I'm having my students dress up as a classical painting or something from art history. So we'll see how that comes out. So fingers crossed. I can also post some of the music that I played onto that folder too, just so that we can kind of riff off of each other. So I did play some Andean music, some African music. I do like to kind of get in some cultural education into this when I play the music, and then also maybe playing something that's a little more contemporary. I played a band called Architecture in Helsinki, and I played Jason Becker, who I said classical guitarist also. So I can put those on in case you wanted to introduce any of that to your students as well.
We did get a request from one of the art, you can see Juliana's got her thumbs up there. She was requesting the music, to know the music. So yeah, so adding that will be great. This also brings to mind for me that when you were just sharing about that and what Lisa said about the distinction between shared space and personal space, and that's an opportunity for students in thinking in terms of that, like getting them up to move, and then they have the choice as to whether to keep their video on or click their video off. They own their own spaces, and you know, and it'd be interesting to explore that with especially middle school students, I think, when they're starting to define their personal identity. And I think that would be an interesting inquiry in relationship to what you're doing about, you know, having this engaged inquiry into what is personal space, what is shared space, what is public space, and how do you show up in the world, and how do you want to show up in the world? Kind of something like that might be interesting to add to this.
Yeah, that's definitely one of the social emotional learning components of it. That's pretty exciting to give them that space to really develop their own identity without so many peer coming down onto that. Yeah.
Just to jump in really quick, and hopefully, by the way, there's an opportunity to kind of share bigger learnings this afternoon. It'll be brief with a large group, but I sat in on Patty and Lisa Rafti's, you know, the local learning. If you don't know these folks, you really need to know them. They're folk artists, and they were talking a lot about the whole equity issue. You know, it's got so many angles, and how students of different equity, the different how students are and are not comfortable, much less adults, representing themselves in their home space. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And they're going to talk, I'm going to ask them to talk about that this afternoon, but it fits with what you're talking about too. You know what I mean, Aida, right?
Yeah.
Huge.
Really, I'm going to say that my session coming up also, if anybody's going to be at it, it plays off of what Patty did and what you're talking about in terms of how do we express ourselves and our identities. So if anybody's going to be at that, we'll continue with this.
Yeah.
Hi guys, I just wanted to add that think that I wanted to apologize for muting my video. I'm okay with muting. I don't want to apologize for muting my audio. Of course, that's proper. But in a lot of workshops, I ask the video to not be muted, especially if it's kids, because I want to see everyone's beautiful faces. And I gave myself, mute my video because, I'm not, in that particular environment. I was very interested in watching the video. But in general, when I teach a class online, I ask for all the video to be up so I can see kids' reactions. I can see, even if they walk away, it's fine with me.
I've also heard from one of the teaching artists, the instructors, that you would be surprised how little materials people actually have at home. And that, you know, making that assumption that even a stapler is there is, you know, you'd be surprised in any home, whether it's, you know, low income or high income, that people are not prepared with materials.
Can I add to that? I was teaching a class. I asked the kids to have brown paper bag and a pencil and a marker, and at least one child did not have anything. They only had yellow pad lined paper to work with, like literally. And a lot of the kids in this particular group are from the Jewish Orthodox community. And it was before Passover, and every family cleaned their house. So there was no materials for most of the kids that, you know, you and I think, oh, they should have at least a paper bag, you know? It's interesting to consider. Nobody had watercolors, only one family did. So it's interesting to consider what kind of mark making you can do with things that are other than art supplies. I am going to pull up a video during my presentation to share. It's in Spanish. It was produced by LACMA, and it's beautiful. It tells you what kind of foods you can use for make mark making. It's really
awesome. Yeah. Yes, totally. I was even thinking maybe I can include that too in my folder, just unconventional art making materials, right? You might have some old nail polish or maybe an old lipstick or ketchup or
food coloring.
Yeah.
Hair color.
Yes, I'm also thinking of what you said, Juliana, about speaking into the listening or speaking into the environment of your students. Like, you happen to have this community that somebody might not even consider that there's this predetermining of what would be available because of a cultural event, because of a religious event. And that's really interesting to think about. We're walking into people's homes, what's happening in their home at that time, you know? Yeah.
I enjoy that personally. I have been really enjoying, and the fact that it's been very reassuring is realizing that most people don't have interior designed homes like I assume everybody does.
Right. Right.
So,
Joe, yeah. Do you know I'm recording for our group, and I see we're going to be shutting down this section. Is there something I need to do because Aida wasn't able to? Is there an instruction about saving it, or does it automatically get saved? You're muted.
I think we'll all just poof vanish in about 50 seconds. And I think you will have your recording, but to be safe, you could stop recording right before the timer says.
Okay,
sounds good. I was gonna ask, and it's also a chance to introduce my pal, the Otis, to, but not to put you on the spot. Lupe, are you here? Not right this second.
No, I'm here. It just wouldn't let me unmute because the seconds thing popped up.
Lupe teaches in and does arts and theater and journalism and ethnic studies in LAUSD. So now you know each other.
Hi. Lupe, we want to get the word out about our Otis Free Art at Homes to the LAUSD group. If you could email me, we can connect. It's just ibush@otis.edu, and I would love to be able to share information with LAUSD.
Great. I would love that. Yeah.
All right. Fantastic.
Thank you.
Great. Aida, you too. I want to share about our free art, you know, in the home, at, you know, with youth. We have a couple of youth ones coming up.
Very resourceful. Thank you.